Thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. One of the many things I'm extremely passionate about is empowering staffing owners with education, resource, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, trends, and emerging challenges in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Alli Arndt and Austin Morgan to join me. Alli is a wellness manager on assurance risk management team with a passion for improving the health of companies and their employees. Alli works closely with her clients to create large-scale corporate wellness programs. After first gaining a solid understanding of the company culture, Alli then helps to develop, implement, and manage a strategic wellness program tailored to their needs. Prior to assurance, Alli was a physical therapy technician at accelerated rehabilitation centers. While there, she worked with patients to develop specific and measurable rehab programs. Austin Morgan is an account executive on Assurance Staffing Employee Benefits team. With 10 years of experience on employee benefits, he focuses on staffing firms on all sizes and types. Austin elects to take a hands-on, client-focused approach to understand each client's unique needs so he can craft the most appropriate solution. He is passionate about saving money for his clients by examining all available markets while staying on the cutting edge of product development. A little bit about insurance. Assurance is among the largest and most awarded independent insurance brokerage in the United States. A top 50 broker, Assurance is a repeated national best place to work winner. Assurance creates value by minimizing risk and maximizing health for over 6,000 businesses and individuals across the country. The company is headquartered in Schaumburg, Illinois, and has centralized offices in Chicago, Illinois, as well as St. Louis, Missouri. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Alli Arndt and Austin Morgan. Welcome, Alli and Arndt. Alli and Austin, sorry.
You're totally fine. It's good.
Thanks for having us, Julie. Going on there.
Happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. So, and I'm, you know, I've worked with you guys. Well, for you, Austin, you and I have known each other from the staffing industry, and it's nice that we know assurance really well from not only the staffing industry, but you guys do our plans for health and wellness as well. So it's also great that we know you intimately that way. Over the past 18 months, there has been a lot of focus on workplace mental health, from articles to the media focus to an influx seminars on this topic. And that's why I brought this topic up and asked you guys to speak on it. Recently, I read the State of the Mental Health report that in America indicated that we have reached our highest level since the pandemic with depression and with also anxiety. So help me understand, why is, you know, mental health in the workplace, it matters? Why is it important?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think that this is, in my opinion, one of the positives that has come out of the last 18 months and all of kind of the unknowns. We have been able to draw some more attention to this really important topic of mental health in the workplace. And it is something in years past that it just wasn't talked about too much, and it kind of has this negative stigma associated. And I think that this is the biggest thing for us to address, is breaking down the stigma and why mental health has this place in an organization or in a workforce. And for me, it's so much more than that. So without looking at all of the different dimensions of wellness, you're not supporting that person's whole person health or total health of the individual. And mental health is a huge component. They're not going to succeed in all of the other areas of their well-being if they're not taking care of their mental health. And as we start to, you know, break down this stigma, people are talking about it more. People are seeking out the appropriate resources that they need to help them navigate really wherever they're at in their mental health journey. And a lot of that starts with education. So why is this important and why are we talking about it? Really, it has a place, and it probably always has had a place. And now we just have the ability to bring it to light a little bit more and make sure that employers are supporting their employees' mental well-being so they are more productive, they are more positive. The culture of well-being is felt throughout the organization.
Yes. Austin, anything more on that? I mean, I must have to agree that since the pandemic, we are talking about it more, which it needed. That whole stigma of there's shame and stigma against anybody suffering from anxiety or any mental health issues. There really is a lot of that, was a lot of that, and still is. And we need to talk about it more and be more open and accepting to it and letting people get away from that shame and stigma of mental health issues.
Well, I completely agree, right? It's now finally okay for people to raise their hand and say, hey, I need help, right? And they're looking to their employers more and more for those resources. And I'm excited, we'll talk more about that as the conversation continues.
Is it, and it is really the workplace culture that sets that tone? Is it not that where it starts is with the employers and that culture for the employee?
I would say so, in really enabling the employees to take the proper channels of support that they need and feel like they're going to be supported from their employer to do just that. And so, you know, even if that C-suite or that executive leadership team is fully supportive of a mental health concept program education, I think that trickles down all the way to the middle management level too, because employees need to feel like they're direct supervisor or manager is also supportive of seeking out any type of mental health support, and, you know, kind of keeping lines of communication open throughout that to establish that relationship with your employee and retain that employee because they know that they're taken care of at the organization.
I think with some of the questions I get from owners, when you're looking at the staffing industry, there are some barriers that they face when they want to roll out a wellness plan. Can you go through the barriers, the typical barriers the staffing industry would face?
Yeah, I can maybe start with that. And then Alli, you can kind of jump in and add some color and some solutions, right? Because wellness is something that I have tried talking about as a consultant with my staffing firm clients for quite a while, but inevitably I run into, you know what, we just don't have the internal resources to deploy a wellness solution, or we know in certain staffing segments, margins are razor thin, so cost inevitably comes up. But those seem to be the two biggest. Alli, do you have any thoughts on those?
Yeah, I would agree. And just determining who the wellness program is going to be offered to within their population. Is it going to be all the internal employees, or is it going to be all inclusive with any, other employees that, you know, the staffing organization, you know, is overseeing? And that, I think, is a big component to creating this culture of well-being, because it's, you know, you're offering it to more of these two separate silos of employees, that culture is not going to be felt as universally in support of well-being as it would if we addressed the full population. So, you know, that, to Austin's point, you know, has a place, you know, when the budget discussions come up too, because sometimes it's not really feasible for the first year of a program to address the entire population. So it's very much a step-by-step walk before we run approach to wellness. And that strategy, you know, comes into play really kind of looking 3 to 5 years out as opposed to just a one-year wellness solution.
Interesting. Okay. Let's talk about cost, because I think that's a big thing. Everybody says, well, I can't afford it. That, I think that's their biggest barrier besides, and I agree with you, internal versus temporary staffing and then the resources. But when I was doing the research on this, there's a lot of low cost to no cost solutions out there. Can you go into the cost and programs and how to, like you said, step into a program and don't run before, you know, don't get into it where it's only 1 year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I think that there are a lot of no-cost solutions. And really the thought behind these no-cost solutions is building a foundation of education on what is mental health and what does that mean to me and the people in my life and my coworkers. What is mental health? And so, you know, starting very simplistic with educational tools, there are a lot out there, but getting them in one spot for employees on a resource guide. This can include apps that they can download and navigate on their own time, podcasts that they can listen to, different resources, hotlines, support lines, even just generalized content around, you know, mental well-being and what that looks like in concepts to consider. So sometimes just that employee-facing documentation that they can kind of even bring home and have it translate home to spouses and even dependents can go a long way. Another, you know, more low or no cost option is to utilize some of your benefits within your benefit package. So one being the EAP. This is a confidential solution, and unanimously, the utilization in EAPs is relatively low. And I think that that has a lot to do with that stigma that we referenced earlier around, you know, employees being hesitant to engage. But those programs are very, very beneficial if utilized appropriately. So trying to get out, you know, communication around the confidentiality of those programs, around the access to different one-on-one type sessions that that EAP may offer, and, you know, making, you know, the contact lines very easily accessible, whether it's a phone number or a chat feature that they can reach out and tap into that EAP. And then lastly, I'll just touch on a generalized communication campaign. So again, in reference to breaking down that stigma, constant communication coming from the organization kind of allude to the fact that the employer is supportive of the mental well-being concept. They're seeing this consistently over the course of the year, not just during May being Mental Health Awareness Month, but they're seeing it every single month. And I think the more that they get that in front of them and start reading on small but beneficial pieces of information, the more that they can start to have that in an application-based setting and form it into their lifestyle and behaviors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well said, Alli. I think I'd like to reiterate your point about using carrier resources, right? So to both of your points, communication, the carriers have so much material that they've already created that then the employer and HR teams really just need to disseminate, right? It's super easy, no cost at all. And then the second one is that EAP. Most carriers have an embedded EAP. Now you will have to have a conversation, right? Who's eligible to call into that EAP, whether it's the external or internal population. But even if your external temp population is not covered by an EAP, there are standalone EAP vendors out there that can provide that service. The only thing I would caution you is when you talk about pricing with a standalone EAP, a lot of times it's a PEPM, right? Per employee per month. And in staffing with such a large employee count, that can be cost prohibitive. But there are some that will allow you to do proposals on like a per service basis. So talk to your consultants. There's a lot of different options out there.
That was a shock to me that you could use the EAP program for your non-internal staff, even if you didn't have it part of the program.
Julie, absolutely. And think about the stuff that they're dealing with, depending on the different firms. You know, I have one client that may be reviewing sensitive website information and going through that. You know, it's a difficult mental situation. Or you may have some, I mean, there's just so many different things that can transpire, especially on the temporary side. They need it as much as anybody.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. And on the communication that Alli was talking about, the general communication, I think where I would like to follow up on there is, not only does the company need to communicate and from an employer supportive role, but I think it really, as you said earlier, Alli, gets into that middle management, the supervisors really communicating. And I think it gets as easy as just spending time talking to your people, you know, being, how was your weekend? How are you doing? You know, you can see a lot body language and then asking, are you okay? And if you're not okay, do you need time away? Do you need 10 minutes to go regroup or 15 minutes to go regroup? And being aware of that and then giving them that time and space so that they can, you know, de-stress for a little bit. But I don't think we do enough of that. We see it and we just go, well, she looks upset, I'm just going to let her be. And that goes with your temporaries as well, is just do a check-in with them and say, how is it going? Not only with the job, but with life. How is life doing?
Yeah, absolutely. opening up those communication avenues, it goes a long way.
Mm-hmm. I think we did a lot of that at the beginning of the pandemic when we were doing all of our calls on Zoom and you know, doing it like this. And we would say, so how are you doing? You know, and we would start a meeting that way. But I think we've got away from that. And I think we need to bring it back again to start our meetings and do a little bit more of check-ins, because as the numbers are indicating, we're at our all-time high. And I think now it's actually, you can see it's wearing on people, because this pandemic that we thought was going to be a couple months and then maybe a half a year turned into 2 years. And so I think there is still a huge need for employers and management to really get engaged with their employees on how they're really doing.
I think you can even take that to the recruiter level, right? I mean, all of our clients keep our talent in-house. How do we put them onto the next assignment? I think just simply asking that question, how are you doing? So that the talent side feels appreciated. They feel cared about. They're not going to move from one staffing firm to the next. So they're like, you know what? I've got a great relationship with my recruiter. Mm-hmm.
Right, right. It goes a long way. I think what next one, when we go to what are next steps, like for like actionable next steps that an employer can take to start a program like this?
Yeah, I think that, again, kind of going back to that strategy and determining, you know, what we can start off with, how can we walk before we run, and then where do we want to take this program? What's at the top end of capabilities to support our employees' mental health? And, you know, a couple of those solutions that are out there, but do require a budget. And again, that's why I say we want to build that into a strategic approach so we can work towards it after we have the foundational education, after we have traction, and after it's a concept in the culture of the organization to address mental health. You know, there are other solutions that are out there, like mental health first aid training, which I think is a wonderful solution. It is enabling team members from all the way, you know, from your leadership team or your HR teams, all the way down to your temp employees even, to sit in during this training and learn about signs and symptoms of mental health and mental illness, how to properly address those symptoms, how to help support others and be very mental health literate, right? So they understand and they're effectively able to address situations and intervene before it gets to a critical capacity. That is a wonderful training. That's a certification that those individuals would have for 3 years. So that's one program that is been shown and been increasingly popular as organizations continue to adjust mental health. Another one are really third-party vendors. So, you know, if you get to a point where you know your population is looking for some support that's a little bit more hands-on, there are third-party vendors that are out there in the marketplace who are able to support your employees from either a coaching aspect for mental health with text support, any time of the day, you know, getting at least some immediate responses back if they're feeling as though they're in a state where they need some support. Additionally, on top of that, there's even the ability to leverage these third-party networks and get a therapy session set up. So when we talk earlier about anxiety and depression being at the all-time high here, this is an active way for us to make sure our employees are getting care, but getting care quickly, as opposed to sometimes needing to call up a provider and schedule out 3 to 4 weeks, you know, out, which sometimes isn't addressing the immediate concern right now. Mm-hmm. So there are solutions out there that, again, take a little bit more of a hands-on approach and have, you know, ability to connect with your individual, you know, capabilities and online modules, and additionally setting up those therapy sessions. And then the last thing that kind of comes to mind is leveraging the telement services. And Austin, I'll kind of throw that one over to you to talk a little bit more about, but that's certainly an option as well.
Yeah, really good point, Alli. So telemedicine anymore is embedded in a number of different programs that staffing companies are offering, right? Major Medical is offering it. A lot of the mech providers you see have telemedicine. And then you can also have standalone telemedicine if you want. And for the folks that don't know, right, telemedicine is that 24/7 access to a health provider via your cell phone. It's a video conference like we're all used to. But what we've really seen in the last 2 years is an increase to mental health providers through telehealth, which is fantastic. So all of those needs that we were talking about before, you can now talk to a registered professional through telemedicine.
Interesting. Alli, I'm going to go back. What was that certification again called? I'm going to highlight that one more time. The training certification for mental health.
It's called mental health first aid is what it's called.
Very good. I think that's really, that'd be great for organizations, especially larger staffing companies that have a large population, to have a few people in their organization to be certified in that. That's huge. I think it's really hard for us to identify sometimes what are the signals and the signs of mental health and how do we handle it? How do we step into that territory that we're maybe uncomfortable with or unaware of and unsure of how to handle?
Finding a response that's more empathetic as opposed to sympathetic. I think that that's a huge component to actively addressing some of these concerns, and then really knowing what to say and also what not to say, because we want to be able to support these individuals and we want them to know that they have, you know, the ability to lean on their support system just the same.
So help me understand, Austin, if somebody is working with you, you're their broker for the health, do they go to you and say, we really want to examine a mental health program? And then do you lead them to somebody like an Alli to help them through that?
Yeah, absolutely. You nailed it, right? So it is something that your consultant should be talking to you about already, right? That comes up in our strategy meetings, our pre-renewal meetings. There's a lot of those different stages kind of that Alli was talking about, right? Depending on how aggressive a firm wants to get with their wellness program. But once we kind of start that conversation, we bring in the wellness specialist. So that's Alli and her team, and they do a full wellness review. There's a few other things that Alli hasn't quite touched on yet. I think we'll get there, but there's also classes that they can do. They do lunch and learns. Alli, I think one of the best or most well-received ones lately has been the cooking classes. Those are pretty cool. Mm-hmm. So Julie, to answer your question, right, it's one of those things, like it's our job as consultants to bring in the true experts.
It's funny you said, Austin, the cooking classes, because when I was doing my research, I said to you earlier, I have 5 pages of different items you can bring in for no cost at all or low cost. And one of them is cooking classes.
With there you go. Like
so Alli, go into that a little bit more, because that amazed me that that would help in this situation.
Yeah, we have a couple registered dietitians on our team. And so leveraging their expertise in just how to properly fuel your body, we're able to pinpoint a topic that would relate to, you know, in this instance, mental health. And so recently we've rolled one out called mood boosting foods. How can you really incorporate foods that are going to help your overall health and well-being, and really put a focus on your mental health specifically, and how you actually prep that meal and execute it. You learn a lot of things about antioxidants, anti-inflammatory foods. You learn things on how to properly position, season, all of those things that kind of come into developing a meal. And then you have that recipe going forward. Additionally, the registered dietitians are able to take questions during the demo. We have invited family members to join in too, to cook along with us at their homes. But it's just a nice interactive experience to kind of, again, take this concept and make it more application-based. We're actually applying it now to the day-to-day. How can we benefit from doing something so small, like prepping a meal, but gaining tremendous value?
Wow. Interesting. Love it. I love it. Really good. What other, anything else that you, either one of you really want to highlight today in our discussion? Because I think this has been a great learning discussion for me, even prepping for it and even today. So anything else you want to highlight?
Julie, I do have a quick kind of final thought, and it's almost where we began, right? Is don't let some of those common objections stop you from starting the conversation. I thought your question about what is the right next step was the perfect one. Just talk to your broker, talk to your consultant, have them and have the wellness conversation. Because to your point, there are low to no cost options that are out there. There's a lot of resources that are available to people.
Yeah, I read that $26 billion in direct treatment costs each year that we're spending as a United States. And employers, it's a direct hit to your bottom line. So it's time loss, it's absentee, it's productivity, it's all that. So any little bit that you can start now and build on, I have to believe it's going to benefit your employee, your in your bottom line, retention, everything. Alli, any other comments?
No, I would echo what Austin said. I mean, we are having probably more wellness discussions now more than ever. Everyone is very focused in on their well-being, as they should be, in my opinion at least. And I'm excited to see how it's translating out into the workforce. And truthfully, I really hope it's translating home too.
So do I. I hope we get rid of that stigma and that we can start having even more open dialogue about it and being respectful of people and when they're going through these times. So,
yep, absolutely.
Well, this has been a great discussion. I really appreciate both your time. I know you're both very busy, especially you, Alli, now doing all of these well things, but it's great. It's you're helping a great need that's out there. We will have your information out for everybody to gather if they need to reach out to you, Austin, or to Alli to get more information and to understand the programs and what they could do in their offices. I also would like to just say that you'll see the podcast information for TRICOM's next one coming up soon, and that will be with Andre Young, who is one of our famous motivational speakers that will be speaking at the TRICOM conference this fall. But I want to, again, thank you both. Enjoy your day, and thank you for the time and the education on this very important subject.